To begin with, you know, because I know 3 o'clock is a very holy hour. And I don't want any one of you to fall asleep. Okay? And because, you know, it's biblical, Pastora, right? You know, when you fall asleep, when you fell, and then we don't want to resuscitate you. It's a waste of time, okay? So what I'm gonna ask you to do is grab a partner. Make sure you have a partner. Other than this fiancé and the thing. Right? Grab the partner, the one who's sitting beside you. Okay? Face your partner. And I will be giving you some instruction, okay? I want you to look seriously with your partner. Really, seriously. Okay? Because I will be asking you to find something on the head of your partner. Making sure that all the holes that I will tell you is in with your partner. When those holes are missing, oh my gosh, that's a big problem. Okay? So, are you ready? So when you pound the holes that I will tell you, you will say, Amen. Okay? So basically, in our head, there are 7 holes. Is this the first time that you heard that? At least you have something to learn today. Right? Okay, let's begin. Are you ready? Yes. Amen. Okay. So first, I want you to see if your partner have 2 eyes. Oh, what you gonna say? Amen. Good. Next, I want you to see if your partner had 2 holes, nostrils. Oh, don't look deeper, okay? Just the outer space, okay? Next, I want you to see if your partner have 2 ears. Because the ears have 2 holes as well, right? What you gonna say? Amen. Okay, the last hole, I want you to say, praise the Lord. Okay? 1, 2, 3. I want you to see that your partner has 1 mouth. Wow! Imagine if your partner have 2 mouths, you would never have opportunity to speak. Right? That's why I'm so blessed that my husband is good in practicing of using his 2 ears because I love to talk. Okay? So praise the Lord. You know, God is really a God of order. He only gave us 1 mouth because imagine, you know, this 1 mouth is where our, this tiny, pinkish, little tongue sits. You know, this one doesn't even have a muscles or doesn't even have a bones. But do you know that this little tongue is so dangerous? Right? It's so dangerous that it can, even without bones, right? It is strong enough to either speak death or life. It can either speak blessings or cursings. That's why, you know, God only give us 1 mouth and 2 ears. Imagine, you know, it's like firewood. Right? If everybody has a lot of mouths, right? Right? Okay. Now, you know, I love to ask questions. You know, that is one of my strategy with my group. So that I know that they, you know, they study, right? Because sometimes they're so dependent on you. So they knew, if I will be the one to teach, they are already ready that the first thing that I will do, I will ask questions. So the same thing with you. I will see how smart you are, guys, but don't worry. You know, Pastor Nap will still adopt you even if you don't answer the questions, okay? Okay. How much do you think a person can speak in a minute? How many words a person can speak in a minute? Oh, everyone is scratching all over here. Wow, why all of a sudden you become itchy? Okay, any guess? 100. Closer. A little bit more. A little bit more. Okay, 100. We have 100 here. How about here? Oh my gosh, that's too much. Pastora, is that the way you speak with Pastor Nap? I feel so sorry for you, Pastor Nap. What a revelation. You know, even in a conversation, it will never even reach 700. Imagine just one person, you don't even have the time to speak. Okay, so we have the 100, 700 is too much. Okay, another one. Okay, 150 to 200. Okay, so imagine in 1 minute, a person can speak around 150 to 200. Now, let's put that context in a conversation. You know, especially when the conversation gets exciting, right? Especially when you're talking to somebody. Oh, come on. Yeah. Right? So in that context, do you know how many words can happen in just 60 minutes or 1 hour? Around 9,000 words, right? That's a lot of words, right? So the question is, how much of those spoken words has been instrumental to build up or crush person's self-image, have tear apart or bring back relationships, have blaspheme or exalt God? Right? Wow, the angel just passed by. And everybody has been quiet. So even myself, when I look back, I have said a lot of words that later on I regretted. Right? It hurts myself. It hurts the people around me. And most of all, it affected my relationship to the Lord. But praise the Lord, I was redeemed. I was born again. And even my tongue was redeemed by the Lord. Amen. That's why what I say today is, amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord, right? Okay. So, every word matters. There is no word wasted. There are always sown into ourselves and others. It is always have consequences. Right? And the sad reality is, words that has been released from your mouth, you can take them back. You can take them back. No matter how much sorry you are, there are already consequences that you will reap. And sometimes, the consequences will take so long. It will take so much pain, especially if pride takes over, right? Amen. Okay, your words speaks volume about who you are. You know the politicians, right? The reason why we voted them, because of the words, because of the promises they say. You know, the products that you bought, you know, they make sure that the words that they will use to introduce the products are really will tickle your minds, right? Even if you don't, you know, you don't even, oh, I don't eat that, but the way they presented it, right? Oh my gosh, I will try that, right? Okay, so we are enticed, we are gravitated because of the words of those people or places that you have seen, right? So because there is power in the word. Okay, who are couples here? Remember the words of your husband now that said to you, you know what, I love you forever. I will do everything for you. Promise. You know, I will change. You know, I will love you forever no matter what, even if you change your bloody figure. Right? Right? And of course, here you are, you believe. And both of you said, I do. Right? Right? Amen. So it is because of the words. So there is power in words, whether are spoken, written, or even the sign language, right? Because what? In the beginning, God spoke the words and the universe came to existence. There is power in words. Brothers and sisters, I just started my introduction. Okay. You know what? That's what I said to Pastor Nap a while ago. Because you know, the problem with me, when I started talking, I don't know how to end. And no matter what, sometimes my husband, I thought he's saying, "Hun, I will wash the laundry later." I never thought that he's telling me, "Hey, let's go," right? Anyway, so I will try my best to respect your time, but please give me some grace, eh? Because you know what? I travel all the way from Mississauga, okay? Okay, so let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great time that you have given us, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we can already feel your presence, oh Lord God. Lord, prepare our hearts and minds to receive the words that you have deposited in my heart, oh Lord God, to release it to your people, Lord God. Let your will be done in our midst. We welcome the Holy Spirit, oh God. Lord, sustain the voice of your servant, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, for this privilege that you have used me to be your mouthpiece, oh Lord God. Once again, Lord, let your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so let's start. This is now. This is it. I promise, okay? So the title of my message is Your Words Matter. Okay? You know, I'm used to Brampton that I'm just gonna see from here. Here. That's a good exercise, right? Okay, your words matter. So let's see in James 3, 5. Okay, it says in James 3, 5, likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small part. So in this verse, we can see that James compared our tongue to a blaze of fire in a forest. Do you know that fire in the forest, it doesn't start like that already. It started with a little one, right? A spark, right? So the same thing, this tiny tongue has the capacity to effect a massive result. You know, in the same way, the few harsh words you say could destroy your relationship you have established or you have built the whole life of those who are around you. In the same way, if you, you know, change it in a different words, in the same way, the few kind words, let's say, thank you, I love you, I miss you, could say can build a strong relationship and inspires others to fulfill their God-given purpose in their lives. You know, sometimes, I don't know, there are some people, they're so stingy to say good things to people, to even compliment. Sometimes when you meet somebody, right? Hey, good morning. As if they don't hear something. I speak English, right? They, no, but don't be discouraged if other people did not respond to you. Continue to do what is right to do. Amen? Okay. Okay. So remember those words that were spoken to you. Remember, right? When we were little, especially those parents who are raising their children, you know, try to be careful with all the words that you're saying to your children. You know what? It is not the physical thing that will stuck on their memories. It is the words that has been cultivated in their minds, in their hearts, right? That's why bullying is more cause people to kill themselves more than the physical thing, right? Because it will engrave in their minds and in their very spirit and soul, okay? So I think and I believe that there are times, you know, that there are spoken words that has been given to us when we are little, especially those people who we trusted, who we love. That's why that's the good thing in our church. We have, you know, it's a promotion, the encounter, right? That's why we do the encounter. That's the opportunity for us to lay down everything, even the words that has been spoken to us that still lingers in our hearts, and sometimes it prevents us from moving forward and fulfilling the destiny that God has prepared before us. Amen? Okay, let's see what James 3, 9, 10 says. Okay, imagine, you know, my voice is like this and still I can talk, right? So imagine if my voice is not like this. I tell you, it will be a conference. Okay. Okay, James 3, 9, 10. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing, my brothers and sisters, this should not be. Okay? This verse reminds us that there is only one exit. Unfortunately, not like the eyes, so you know, you have to, you can cover this one, and if you want, don't want to see the other part, then just cover this one. Okay? But unfortunately, there is only one exit where our words can be released, and that is our mouth. Okay? So, a classic example, and I know it's not happening in this church, right? A while ago, we sing, we praise the Lord, and maybe when Pastor Knapp is saying about the altar, you give it all to the Lord, and then all of a sudden, because your speaker today talk, you know, we came a little bit late, and then your rush going home, and then somebody cut you off, right? And then because of that, of course, stirred up your emotion, and the mouth is about to say something, okay? Be reminded, you know, the same mouth that you praise the Lord could be the same mouth that you will use to curse that person, okay? So if you will not be on guard with our mouth, you could say words that will dishonor God. Amen? Amen? Hey, that's two of you, okay. Okay, the next slides. I will not bring you home, okay? I even treat you before coming here to make sure that you are fully charged. Okay? Okay, let's see the next slide. Next slides, okay? So your words affect your relationship, first and foremost to God, to yourself, okay, and others. Okay, let's kind of like briefly this explain about this, okay? How it affects your relationship to God about your word, okay? What kind of words that you say to God? Do you honor God with your words? By saying, Lord, I love you. I worship you. I praise you. Everything belongs to you because your prayers has been answered. How about when things are difficult? And your prayers, you know, God did not answer you because God knows what is best. But you don't wait, you know, Lord, I want it right now. Why are you not giving it right now? So because of that, you hate God. You know what, God? That's enough. You know, I don't want to wait. You're too late, right? So it affects your relationship to God, even the very word that you say to God, okay? So how it affects your word with yourself, right? Do you declare the promises of God to yourself? Okay? Let's say you say, I am a child of God. You know? I'm a conqueror. I am not a loser. You know? I'm not a tail. I'm the head. You know? I'm a lender. I'm not the borrower. Right? Or, because you are in the world, you say what people say you are. Yes, I know. I'm a loser. You know, I'm not good for nothing. Yeah, you are right. Right? So whatever word you declare yourself, you fulfill what you said. So your word affects how your self-image of yourself. Do you believe about the self-image that has given to you, or you believe what people said to you? Amen? And how about the others? Of course. I don't want to be around to murmurers. I don't want to be around to people, you know, early morning. What they're going to say to you are already negative words. Right? I don't want to around with people with critical spirit. And those who always believe that they are the best. Right? Who wants to be with those people? Nobody, right? So if you that kind, everything that comes up in your mouth are those words of this characteristic, people of this characteristic, nobody would want to be with you. So your words will affect your relationship with others. Amen? Okay. Getting exciting, right? I tell you, you will not go home. No. Don't worry. How many pages is this? Okay. Let's go to Proverbs 18:21. Okay? Proverbs 18:21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. You know what? When I'm looking at the different translations of this verse, I was amazed that majority of the translation, you know, death comes before life. And I said, wow, there is something into it, right? Because normally we when we read this verse, we always, maybe you take the NIV. The NIV translation says, there is life and death in the tongue. But in most translations, death comes before life. You know, and I think it, Lord, give me the, you know, how so that I can reason out with the good people. Right? So, you know, the Holy Spirit, what you call this? Where's the word? Okay. The Holy Spirit told me that, you know, because we are in a fallen world, right? Yes, we are being redeemed, but still, we are still in the flesh, right? So if we will not be mindful, because the senses, our senses, are normally the entry points that the enemy use to have a foothold in us. So meaning to say, don't just kind of like, you know, always speak, of course, life is good, but we always have to be mindful that the enemy can use our ignorance, can use our being lax, you know. That's why we always need to be always on guard. We always have to watch what is coming out in our mouth, right? Because it can bring death over and life. Amen? It makes sense, right? Amen! Oh my gosh, you will not have a Tim Hortons going home. Okay, so don't ever say curse word to your life, but always speak blessings. No matter what, even if you see that, you know, Sister Banji, it's easy for you to say that, but this is what's happening. No, you know our faith, right? Faith is believing even before we see it. And we know, if we really trace back, there's so much thing that we can recall that God has done in our lives. You know, God has proven his track record that if he did that before, what is the reason why he cannot do it again? Amen? Amen? So don't ever speak cursing, okay? Always speak blessing. Lord, we will be abundance. Lord, all the people in this church will be coming, Lord, because they're out the back and there are empty chairs here in Jesus' name, right? All these chairs, Lord, will be full of people who will be excited to worship you and to honor you. Amen. Amen? And next time, I also prophesy that you guys will come here so that those who are latecomers will be at the back. Amen. Do you know, when you come, when you go to the concert, the most expensive, right? The most expensive, the front row, right? And we are going to the house of the King of Kings. Why do you want the sprinkle when you can soak to the blessing of the Lord? Honestly. So maybe if the, you know, famous star will be coming here, oh my gosh, Pastor, I think they will come up to him. Right? This is the house of the Lord. Me in Brampton, they knew me. I bought the first two rows. Even no matter what, I always make sure, that's it, there's a big name there. A Sister Evangeline. Okay? Because, you know, I want to get the best. I want to make sure when I come to the house of the Lord, there should be no interruption. No interruption. I want to give the best. Because, you know, when you go out there, I will ask one by one. Yeah, I have the survey form. But do you remember with my preaching? No, I'm just kidding. Okay, let's go. Okay, so let me share to you the five ways we can use words to bring death. So we will, you know, I love acronyms. Maybe because, you know, I'm getting old and it's so easy to remember, you know. Okay, so we will use the word acronym death, okay? So there are 5 words in the word acronym that brings death. Okay, so let me remind you that all these 5 words would have a direct negative impact to ourselves, others, and most of all, our relationship with God. So let's go with first one, destructive. Letter D, destructive criticism. Okay, so Proverbs 15:4. Okay, Proverbs 15:4 says, gentle words are the tree of life, a deceitful tongue crosses the spirit. Okay, I don't know, you know, you can observe it. Tell me if I'm not right. Okay, or if I'm not right, just keep it to yourself. Okay, normally when there is gathering, right, and then the person there wanting to see you, and well, how come that the first thing that we will say to the person is the first thing that the person doesn't want you to notice, right? Let's say, you know, the person would even wear a black dress, you know, try to make sure that she or he looks slim, and the first thing that you say, oh my gosh, I think you gain weight, right? You know, right? I don't know. Why already criticize the person? You know, the person even kind of like wear something that will cover everything, right? Anyway, so, okay. Okay, so, instead, okay, this is what we're going to do. Even though that is a destructive criticism, we can, you know, we can reframe it in a way that would not be, insulting to the other person, okay? Instead of using words to highlight people's weakness, use words that will build people's strength to uplift their spirit, to uplift their morale, okay? Instead of using words to find faults, you know, sometimes we, you know, your husband, let's say, first time to cook, and then the husband really make it a really good presentation, you know, just say, oh, honey, I thought this is, you said this is sinigang, but I thought it is nilaga. Right? You know, say, oh, you can say, oh, thank you, I like the way you present it, instead of criticizing it, right? Yeah. Because, you know, next time around, your husband or whoever who doesn't cook in the house and wanted to cook, that person will never, ever again, okay? So instead of using words to fault finding, use words to bring the best in people by praising them for their accomplishment and always giving them opportunities to showcase their good God's given talent and anointing, especially in the life group. Okay? Always give that room for every members of your group, you know? Maybe, you know, you say sister or brother, or you do the prayer, and then don't say to the brother, oh my gosh, what kind of prayer is that? Right? Don't. The sister or brother will not pray anymore. Okay? Right? Excite the person. Oh my gosh, I love your prayer, sister. Okay? Always give words of encouragement, prayers, and words of wisdom to give them room for improvements instead of putting them down. How many of us, you know, experience that being put down? You know, even in our own family, I believe, you know, sometimes you say, oh, your sister is better than, you know, this and that, the comparison things and etc. Parents, don't ever do that. And even in the life groups, don't ever do that. We are created by God unique, and that's the good thing with that. You know, even your own fingers are not the same, right? Right? That's the beauty of that. Diversity is something that we have to embrace and something that will really bring a lot. Amen. Never ever compare yourself to others. Embrace what is good to other person and allow everyone to have the room to prove and to get better. Amen. Okay. Use words to build up and not to destroy oneself, image, and future. You know what? As I said a while ago, every word matters, because in Matthew 12:36 says, I tell you this, you must keep an account on judgment day for every idle word you speak. So even the word that you speak is being accounted by God. Okay? So if you have nothing to say good, just sip it up. Okay? if the zipper will not be enough, staple it. Okay? Okay? Rather than during the judgment day, oh my gosh, the list is so long, right? And the line is already long because God is not done yet with you. Okay? So make sure every word matters. Amen? Number two, okay. This number two, okay, excessive praise for personal gain. So according to Proverbs 29:5, those who flatter their neighbors are spreading nets for their feet. Okay. You know, in the Philippines, I think there's also Spanish here, right? There is such word like bulero or bulera. Those people who try to say something about you, try to tickle your ears, try to flatter you, but at the back of their mind said, as if she thought of what I'm telling is true. Right? Right? You will say the person, oh, you're really great, but at the back of my loser, right? You know? So you try to compliment excessive praise to manipulate the person. So even though that you know that you're lying, you're just flattering the person because you have your personal agenda, and now the person is trapped, and the person doesn't have any choice. And then you say, you know what, sis? And the person is already have a big head, right? Because of all the flattering words that you said. And then all of a sudden, hey, sister, by the way, can I ask you something? And this poor girl or poor boy cannot say anymore no. Because, you know, she or he tends to believe that everything that you said are true. So he or she has been trapped, and then nothing can do but just to give in with your personal agenda. Okay? Amen. I know it's not happening in this church, so you can tell that to your neighbors. Okay? Okay, number three. Wow. A. Attacking others out of anger. Okay? Proverbs 15:28. The heart of the godly thinks carefully before speaking. The mouth of the wicked overflows with evil words. So even our words is connected what is in our hearts. That's why there is a verse that out of the abundance of, that's the name of my group, out of the abundance of your heart, the mouth speak. So we can, you know, that's why we see some people who is so bitter, so angry, you know? And then if you dig further, unfortunately, these are the same people who have a lot of, you know, bitterness, unforgiveness, and so on and so forth. Because again, out of the abundance of your heart, the mouth speaks. Do you know when you're angry, you are so emotionally driven, right? You're emotional. Your mind, meaning to say your mind, is overruled by your emotions, right? So when you're so angry, you know, it's not that you are not strong or whatever, but especially, you know, the husband and wife, when you clock, 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 and you know, the wife, clock, 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 just remove yourself, right? That's a good marriage counseling, huh? Okay? You know, when the wife is clock, 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 you just remove yourself to the situation to prevent any trouble. Because an angry person, you know, it's an emotions, right? It's sometimes they cannot control it. The brain cannot stop that. But after that outburst, then they have no choice but they get tired. Right? And that's it. Right? Right? Do you know that most crimes were committed because of anger and hate? Right? So meaning to say, when you are emotional charged, don't even do anything. That's why, you know, the, you know, salesperson, that's what they use. Right? You know, they want you to, you know, they use words, right? To make you buy something or whatsoever. Right? You know? Actually, that's not a good example for that. It's supposed to be on the other one. I'm just... How come there is a sales thing there, right? I know, I'm just trying to see whether you are really listening or not. Right? That's not a good example for that. How come that's a salesperson goes with that, right? Oh, what is happening to this now? I don't know. Okay, so basically, a piece of advice, okay? I just want you to make sure that you're alive. Because we're in the church, right? Okay, a piece of advice. If you're negatively and emotionally charged, just seal your mouth, as I mentioned a while ago, or remove yourself from the situation to avoid troubles. The word you speak also shows the conditions of your heart. As I said a while ago, Bible says, the overflow of your hearts, the mouth speaks. As a children of God, the words that should come out from our mouth are things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely. These words are pleasing to God. Number four, what is better?
Tea.
Oh my gosh, this one. Talking behind someone's back. Gossip. Okay, gossip, okay? Proverbs 11:13. I know this is not happening in Guelph. I will see if it is happening in Brampton. No, it's not. Okay. Proverbs 11:13. A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy person keeps a secret. Okay? The scripture, okay, remember, forcefully condemns gossip. Okay? Gossipers, do you know how a gossiper looks like? A gossiper is like a walking, talking advertisement. Right? Because, you know, normally gossipers, they go around to make sure that the rumors will be spread, the secret, right? And not only that, if you see a gossiper, as if you're seeing a person with a huge megaphone attached to their mouth, right? Because normally gossip is a secret, and this gossiper, you know, they revealed it to somebody. Oh, you know what? This is a secret. This is a promise, pinky promise, huh? Don't let anyone, that's a dope, promise, cross my heart, right? Okay? So, and normally, you know, gossipers are usually people who have nothing to do with that, with the issue. But you put yourself into that, right? So as a children of God, we must not start, be involved, or even celebrate, or worse, tolerate gossips. If you can't stop them, you must run away from them. Okay? Gossip will spread like a virus that will poison and eventually destroy relationships. Do you know? Okay? That it takes a lot of courage and trust for that person to reveal that secret to you, and you just take it for granted. How would you feel if you will be the one who will be gossip around? How would you feel? I think, Pastor, we will have an altar call. Okay, right? So spare yourselves to be part of the vicious cycle of gossips. Amen? There is only one person that we could gossip around, and that name is Jesus. Amen? Amen? If you gossip about the good news of Jesus, that would save lots of lost souls. Okay? There's a lot of people that will not go to hell because they knew the good news, because you gossip around about Jesus. I don't know, right? Actually, before I left Brampton, I asked, because there is a word, marites. And I don't know if it's, I think for the Filipino community, they're familiar with that. And I said, because I know I'm not in the Telis area or whatever, but, you know, for curiosity's sake, the marites is a word in the Philippines that, kind of like describe a woman who kind of like gossipers. Mari is a woman, you know, and then test, what is the new latest? That's why they said Mari test. Yeah. So we are called not to be a Samaritan, but we are called to be an ambassador for Christ. Amen. Okay. So the last one in the acronym? H. Wow. So this one is hateful speech to slander others, okay? Whoever conceals hatred with lying lips and spread slander is a fool, according to Proverbs 10:18. So unkind words can pierce the hearts like a sword, right? Damaging the good reputation of someone. False accusations hurt people and should not be spoken by believers. Even in the rule of court, it's a criminal and civil offense. If proven, you will be sued between 10,000K to 25,000K. That's a lot of wasted money because of hateful speech to slander others. Okay, so if there is death, what is the other one?
Life.
And this is the words that we should focus. So there are four ways we can use our words to bring life using the acronym LIFE, okay? So this is the word that we should speak, okay? So the first one, I will speak words that are loving words. So the loving words are not only for the lovebirds, okay? The loving words are for us. You know, sisters and brothers, you know, right? So, Proverbs 16:24 says, gracious words are honeycomb. That's why me and Pastor Nap are diabetic because of loving words. Honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. We are so sweet, Pastor Nap. Okay? That's why, okay? Okay. As followers of Christ, we should reflect the truth of the gospel through our words and the way we live our lives, okay? Our words should impact our conversations for the better as we bring different flavor to our interactions. It should reflect God's love, builds others up, bring healing, joy, and peace, amen? Number two. Okay, what is the next with L? You know the alphabet, okay? I will speak words inspired by God, okay? So in 2 Timothy 3:16, 17 says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. There is only one sacred and inspired book that could inspire and transform people's lives, and that is the Word of God, the Bible. Depend on God's Word, not on your own words. Okay? Soak yourself with the Word of God. So every time, when you are full of the words of God, you cannot help. But everything, that's why, you know, in the office, they knew that I'm a Christian because sometimes I forget and say, instead of saying yes, I said amen. What evangelist? We are diverse here, you know, religion should not be part of, because sometimes I said amen, you know, right? Okay, because when you are full of word, you cannot help. But what will come out from your word are the word of God. Amen? Okay. Number three, I will speak words that are fun, loving. Colossians 4:6. We are almost there. Okay? Fun, loving. Colossians 4:6. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Okay? Especially when we are sharing the word of God. We don't need to be, you know, fighting to the person. Right? We need to kind of like be compassionate with them, try to understand where they are thinking that way, right? No, this is not a competition. We are there to share the love of God, okay? So, don't be too legalistic in your conversation, right? Don't be too legalistic, oh my gosh, right? Okay, don't be a killjoy. I won't be coming to life proof that is not, have no joy. Right? In my life group, you know, we always have fun. That's why, you know, the 1 hour become a conference. Okay? Christians should be full of life. Because the God that we serve is gives us life. So show that we're full of life. Okay? We should not be boring. Oh, I'm not boring, right? Okay. Amen, right? Right? Do you know, my brother and sister, I'm supposed to be a comedian, but God has called me to the ministry. Okay. Have fun. Don't be judgmental. Okay? You know, don't be a judgmental. Okay? Bring life in every conversation in your life group. There is nothing wrong to be funny. There is nothing wrong that sometimes you crack jokes, but should be a clean jokes. You can make jokes about your pastor. No. Delete. Okay. Number four. What is number four? Okay. He didn't hear it. Okay. Number four. I will speak words that are edifying. Ephesians 4:2-9 says, "Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers." Okay? So what does it mean? Words like, "You did a good job. Keep up the good work. You are amazing. You are a team player. I am blessed with your life." Who would not want to hear those words? Tell me. You don't want to hear those words? Right? Right? Because, you know, sometimes, you know, I'm so blessed that I was, you know, I'm in the field that I hear a lot of normally sad stories. You know, if I only know how to write scripts, I have written a lot of scripts, right? So, praise the Lord, right? That, you know, people sometimes, they need to be validated. They need to hear good words. Because there's so much already around us that, you know, people were so depressed, they are discouraged. So just a simple smile, simple hi, hello, good morning, God bless you, is something. But sometimes we thought that is nothing. But for somebody, that is really precious. Amen? So as I conclude my message, finally, honestly, it's not introduction, it's a conclusion, okay? As I conclude my message, my brothers and sisters, I pray that the next time words will come out from your mouth to either say something or respond to others, don't hesitate to pause, okay? To think through whether the words that will come out from your mouth will bring death or life. Because once your words have been released, remember, you cannot take them back. King Solomon, remember what King Solomon, this is a good reminder for all of us. In Proverbs 21:23, he says, "Whoever guards his mouth and his tongue keeps his soul from troubles." Thank you, and God bless us all.